So Lord Diltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin. Be Order Undivided, Castor, Julian, Undri, Peregrine, Senkit, and Eort, Paladins one and all. Oh, and one cat. Her name is Bast, and she is adorable. The Paladins are still traveling north to the ruined city of Zahn Jonas, and so far things have been quiet. With the destruction of the Null Band and Clunny's Legion, this area is actually relatively safe to travel, at least up to the bridge. As they cross, Eort speaks with them. This is where things get a shade more hairy. We're closing in on Orc territory. Clunny made a point to cull most of the dangerous wildlife, but the Orcs are somewhat less proactive. Even outside of the monsters, we've got the Orcs themselves in this area. I'm not sure how many tribes are in the area, but there's at least one tribe of them, plus several bands of ogres. So we've ne got to look far to find Groby to kill. Ah, didn't he mind even a wee bit? Kazdor says with a grin, and War Pig snorts in agreement. I suggest we stop slightly sooner than before then. I'll need time to fortify our encampment, or we're going to have to find somewhere more defensible than just the side of the road, Julian advises. Undri stands up on her still moving stag and looks out. To her west she can see tall hills on the horizon, with plains in between. To the east the forest stretches on over rolling hills and dales. Behind them, to the south, the falling away of the woods to a fertile plain. Before them, to the north, the land seems mostly flat, though it does become hillier ahead. I believe we may reach those hills ahead by tonight if we hurry, she says as she sits back down, then increases her mount's pace. The party nods and increases their speed to match. As the sun begins to set, they are surrounded by the long shadows of the hills, and climb one to set up camp atop it. Before a fire is lit, Julian gathers branches and severs several limbs from trees with the leaves still intact to form a screen around the camp to obscure the fire and serve as a makeshift barricade. It is not needed though, as the night passes without incident. At the dawn, they depart, scattering their fire and riding down the hill and back to the road. The old highway curves between the hills and around their sides. The Paladins remain constantly on alert, wary of ambush. Their wariness serves them well, as shortly after their noontime meal, a piercing, bugling cry rings out through the hills. The party halts and scans around for the source, before Undri looks up and shouts a warning, pointing to the foe before seizing her bow. Out from the hilltops a flock of hideous abominations fly towards the party. They have the bodies of great birds the size of a man, with sharp talons and great wings, but their heads are those of stags. The party is dumbstruck and has no idea what the hell these things are, but such hideous monstrosities must be destroyed. Undri draws back her bow and puts two shots into the leader of the five, wounding it but not killing it, as the flock clasps wings to sides and dives to strike, claws outstretched. It goes for Undri's heart, claw aching at the chain shirt and leaving long scratches. Frustrated, it rakes at her with its horns, but the agile elf dodges away. The more heavily armored party members fare better against the assault, but the creatures are too swift, slipping away before they can properly retaliate. However, there is a shout as one of the monsters seizes Peregrine in its claws and begins to flap upwards and away with him. Kazdor roars in frustration at the cowardly foe. Julian, get the wee lad, I'll aid Undri. Senkit, fire support, he orders as he wheels War Pig and charges the one attacking Undri. He draws only one axe, using his free hand to seize the monster by the wing. He hacks at it twice and tosses it before him to be trampled under the charging boar. Julian tosses Senkit his crossbow and takes off at top speed towards the one grappling Peregrine and lays into it, sending the three crashing into a nearby tree. The smaller Paladin takes the opportunity to slip the monster's grasp, dropping into a lower branch and whipping out his sling to pelt it with bullets. Senkit catches the heavy crossbow, looks at it with a slightly bemused glance, and then drops it before hurling a bolt of fire into another monster, setting its wings alight with unnatural purple flames. Undri gives Kazdor a nod of thanks before retargeting. One shot flies wide, but the second strikes true into the blazing beast, dropping it onto the path with a crashing splat. Eort picks up the fallen crossbow and fires, nailing the so unengaged creature as it swoops in to strike Andre from behind. Its screech of pain is enough to alert her to its presence and she whirls. She blocks its talons with her bow, but is flung from her mount. The elk bugles angrily and strikes the creature from behind as it tries to rip out the elven woman's heart. Khazad-dûr turns from his broken foe and charges back. The war pig cannot turn swiftly enough, so he leaps from its back and charges the monster. He lunges and tackles it to the ground, claw around its throat. His axe comes up and down twice, and the beast lies still. Julian is not faring as well against his monster. His great blade is caught in the branches of the tree, and the heavily armored knight is just barely able to keep his balance. The monster rushes him, leaping up to slash open long rents in his unarmored wings. Icha runs freely, and the monster headbutts Julian, finally costing him his balance and sending him plummeting to the ground with a crunch. Peregrine watches his friend fall, reaching out to catch him, but his arms are too short. His bone-hilted blades are in his hands in an instant, and he plunges one into the tree's trunk. Necrotic energy flares and rots the old pine, and it can no longer hold up its own weight. The creature lets out a weird shriek as it falls, flapping its wings desperately to try to hold itself aloft. Peregrine decides that this will not stand, and leaps atop it, driving his blades into where the wings meet its back. It screams as it plummets into the ground, breaking the halfling's fall. With the monsters dead, the paladins tend to their wounded. Peregrine helps Julian sit up, sending healing energy to repair the broken spine. Khazad-dûr offers Andre a claw, and she takes it. Sturdy fortifying magic flows from the dragonborn into his friend, closing the gashes. Julian stands, somewhat unsteadily, but walks it off. What in the nine hells were those things? Yort asks as he returns the crossbow. No clue, Julian says, to the surprise of the rest of the party, who then look at Peregrine, who also shrugs helplessly. Hey, I'm pretty sure I'd remember if there were any stories about a party of heroes getting mobbed by elk hawks. This is just flat out weird, he says, considering I've never seen Peritons mentioned or used in any adventure or module outside of their entry in the manual. I can't blame him, criminally unroost monster. The party progresses to their next camp quickly, but without further incident. The night passes without an attack, but the party can hear the cries of unseen creatures in the dark, along with the howling of wolves in the distance. The next day, they ride once again quickly, drawing ever closer to the ruined city. Now they can see the remains of stone towers atop the hills, ancient sentries now left to the degradations of time. As they proceed, they come to a stop when they hear a noise in the distance. The party moves off the path and moves slowly. As they draw closer, Peregrine's ears turn red as he realizes what the sound is. It's singing, technically speaking. He explains. Although orcs can't carry a tune in a bucket. Orcs then, Andre says. Shouldn't be any trouble. Don't be so sure. The tribes up north were strong enough to drive Cluny and several other legions out of Zahn Jonas, Yort warns, and the party heeds him, proceeding with caution. What are they singing anyways? Andre asks and Peregrine turns very red. Something that really, really shouldn't be sung, is all he will say on the matter. As the party comes upon the source of the singing, they can see a triumphant war band moving up the road, with a heavily built war wagon laden with booty. Before and behind it a score of orcs march, led by a particularly tall orc in full plate, riding a horse and bearing a crude banner aloft. In the wagon are the largest orcs. The most massive specimen wears no armor, but bears a mighty maul on his back. The second largest also wears no armor, wears a spear, or perhaps a quarterstaff, wrapped in cloth on his back, and is missing one of his eyes. Despite being smaller, this one bears an aura of power that no other can match. Besides him sit two bodyguards, also in plate, bearing great axes. The last two in the cart are something of a mystery. One, the hairiest orc that any of them have ever seen, wears a mighty bow on his back and is clad all in furs. He is currently sleeping despite the racket. The other is the leader of the racket, beating on a great drum to keep the song going. The last thing of note is the cart itself and what is pulling it. The cart is clearly not of orcish origin, but instead looks as though it was made by dwarves and then looted. Dragging it is a massive oxen-like creature, easily larger than even the most massive cattle. It is covered in shaggy fur and has gigantic, brutal-looking horns that resemble spears more than anything else. Looks like a raiding band, a rather successful one at that. we might want to steer clear. Eorth cautions, I count 20 and 6, including their commanders. With the element of surprise, we could take them. Julian observes, they are only orcs after all. Still, no need to get overconfident, Andri advises. We need a plan. Right, Julian says as he scratches out a crude battle map in the dirt. That wagon is going to be a strong point. We are going to want to deal with them without too much interference. If we can draw away and cull the foot soldiers first, we'll have a much easier time of it. So we'll need some form of bait, Peregrine says, looking to Andri. Someone who's fast enough and good enough at range to skirmish effectively, and also a target the orcs will engage without thinking twice about. I'll do it, no need to dance around the point, Andri says. The foot soldiers won't be able to catch me on Pan, her stag, but I will need someone to deal with that horseman. Coordinated ranged firepower can drop them out, then I'll deal with the rider. Senkit says, I'm the best suited to a one-on-one out of all of us except maybe Peregrine, but we'll need him to help break the rest of the group with Castor and Julian. The schooners on that wagon will be up and at us knee long after we've hit them. We'll need to break them on the charge, then turn in time. I'll deal with the big laddie. I imagine the schooner with the wee bow will be shooting, un, ye to deal with them. Agreed. I'll deploy in front of them, drop the horse, and bait them into a charge. Once you engage, I'll circle around to place as much fire as I can into their backs. The paladins nod and move into a new position in front of the band. Andri moves out even further, and then rides out onto the path before them. The orcs are surprised for a moment, and in that moment Andri takes aim and fires, wounding the lead rider's horse. Elberna the Gitonal. Revedil Ganad. She challenges them in Elvish, and the horde lets out a collective roar of hatred. The mass surges forwards, ancestral hatred turning their already hot blood magmatic. In the back near the war wagon, the driver stands and draws his maul, the bodyguards leap to their feet, and the drummer begins to beat and chant. Orc theme music.mp4. The warchief rises calmly though, and nudges the bowman awake. It seems we found an excellent meal for tonight. He informs the ranger, who stretches awake, standing up and looking around unconcerned. As the horde charges forwards, the banner bearer is slowed by his wounded mount, unable to close the distance. As he moves forwards, he suddenly questions why his mount was targeted, and why a single elf was all that engaged. Through the red sharpness of rage, he sees more clearly than most. Hold, it's a trap. He roars in order as he pulls up to halt his steed. Not swiftly enough though as a crossbow bolt fells it and sends him sprawling into the dirt. The trap is sprung as Julian, Castor, and Peregrine come charging out of the woods, Eort reloading his crossbow behind them. Warpig smashes into the rear of the charge, scattering grey-skinned humanoids with furious bulk. From atop it Castor cleaves down into the orcs, a dwarven song of ancient grudges on his lips, metaphorically speaking. Peregrine rides into the center, slipping between foes as he slashes apart tendons and hamstrings, dropping three to the ground, while his mount pounces upon a fallen and seizes the orc in his jaws. The hound shakes his head like it was killing a rat and breaks the orc's neck. Julian is at the front of the horde, blocking the path to Andri with a wall of Distria and whirling steel. He runs one orc through on the charge, then severs an arm before sending an orc head whirling away like a golf ball. 4. It's only 3. Ye Ramage, can ye knee count? Castor asks, slightly annoyed that the Arcanist appears to be cheating. Senkit ignores the competition and rides straight for the fallen bannerman. He raises an arm to defend himself as he fully expects to be trampled, but the Ugnadan leaps over him, kicking away another orc as Senkit dismounts, bashing down another orc and smashing a third's chest open. Get up, for today you die on your feet. She orders him, but does not attack yet. Andri urges Pan on, slipping away from the orcs who slipped past Julian and firing twice into them, dropping another. The tough creatures take a good deal to put down. In the back, the Orcish Ranger draws back his mighty horn bow, and fires. A good idea to take down the steed. Thanks for the idea, meat. 2 crow-feathered arrows slam into Pan, staggering the face stag. It flickers briefly as it begins to lose its hold on this realm. Several other orcs get the idea and a hail of javelins flies from the orcs on the edges of the melee. Andri rolls clear as her mount is banished, but a javelin slams into her armor, unable to pierce the fine steel weave, but with enough force to crack a rib underneath it. The bannerman stands up, drawing his sword and readying his shield. You should have killed me when you had the chance, he informs Senkit as he rushes forwards. Mason's sword meets in a flurry of sparks, before York flicks his wrist and moves his sword in an arc, cutting Senkit's wrist and forcing her to drop the weapon. The skilled sword's Orc strikes again, stabbing past her defenses and cutting her in the armpit where her armor is weakest. The driver Orc leaps over the great bull and hits the ground running, moving faster than anyone the paladins have ever seen. Khazad-dûm Misty steps in front of him and meets the charge with two axes into the chest. The massive Orc simply growls in annoyance. In the center, Peregrine dodges and weaves through the retaliatory onslaught, but he's caught from behind when the Orcs he thought he had down struggle back up and lay into his back. Seems you're tougher than I remember. Sorry about that, he grins through the pain. Before turning his mount, he brings one down with a cut through the groin, and a second by removing his leg at the knee. The retriever rips a chunk out of the third survivor's thigh, dropping him to a knee, allowing Peregrine to remove his head. Julian sees Undri fall and the Orcs rushing for her, and his eyes blaze crimson. This will not stand, he declares as he unleashes his power, the wrath of a god about him sending even the gods worn Orcs scattering in fear as he charges by their ranks. Trampling one unfortunate underfoot as he leaps from his steed and descends like a bolt of lightning into the Orc ranks, hewing them down all about him in a whirlwind of blazing light and black blood. Senkit takes a moment to look at her fallen weapon. Do you really think that has any hope of stopping me? She asks as she strikes out with the edge of her shield, cutting into the Orc in a blast of golden flame. As he falls to the ground, she raises a hoof and stomps down. Thrawn, yes, that's his name. I'm getting tired of referring to him as Bannerman, just barely rolling away before she crushes his skull. She bends to retrieve her weapon and strikes him again, sending him sprawling with blood oozing from the side of his head. Undri rises to her feet and draws back her bow, aiming for the Orc Ranger. The shot is at the edge of her bow's effective range, so one falls short. The second shot flies true though, right into the Ranger's throat, where it breaks in half against his skin, as though she had fired it into a stone wall. He grins at her wolfishly, and pulls back his bow. Julian's Terror Aura does an excellent job pushing back the Orcs, but arrows cannot feel fear. Two black shafts pierce Undri's stomach and she falls to a knee, coughing up blood. The Orc barbarian looks at the axe he's buried in his chest and then reaches out and grabs Khazad-dûm by the throat, growling like an animal as he lifts the massive dragonborn off the ground with one hand, and with the other, slams him with the maw like a cow carcass hanging from a hook. The Orc lord watches on and smiles as his champions do good work, or save one. He looks at Thrawn, sprawled out across the ground, and Senkit ready to finish him off. For a moment he considered letting her remove the disappointment, and then sighs. Waste not, want not, he pulls the javelin from his back and lets the cloth fall. The smell of ozone fills the air and the crackle of electricity sounds over the battlefield as the Orc lord raises aloft the lightning bolt and hurls it like ancient Zeus. Senkit feels every hair on her body stand up and starts to turn when the spear hits her in the back, just between the shoulder blades. The tiefling screams in agony as the bolt hits her with enough force to shatter her armor, and falls to a knee, catching herself on her shield. Even unconscious, the stubborn paladin refuses to fall. Khazad-dûm hears the scream, and with what air he has left in his lungs, blasts the mighty Orc in the face with a gout of flame, forcing him to drop him. He snatches his axes out of the barbarian and rushes to Senkit's side. Peregrine also hears the cry, and cuts his way out of the mob around him. Julian, we need to fall back, he shouts. The Arsimer looks at the mess everyone is in and nods, turning to Undri as she struggles to stand. He looks her in the eyes and commands her, run. For a moment the elf stiffens as she struggles against the magic, before it takes hold and she turns, no longer feeling the pain. Senkit's eyes are still open, but she can't see anything. She labors to breathe, trying to get to her feet, but her muscles won't respond. She hears words distantly, as though everything is far away. Get up. Get up, you aren't done yet. You have to get up, she tells herself. Undri's body runs, but her mind isn't all there. She isn't trying to fight the control as her body runs away. Inside her trance, the world falls away, into a blackness lit by dark vision. She is still running, but this wasn't now, this was when. In dreaming memory and waking trance she runs. The barbarian shakes his head to clear his vision, and gets up to charge the insolent dragonborn when a bolt hits him in the knee. As he stumbles, he falls altogether as Eort charges in, smashing his crossbow into the huge orc's jaw and knocking him down. Kaz, get on. The orc ranger fires at the fleeing elf, but she is beyond his range. Next to him, the orc chief, now totally without any weapons, steps off the cart and walks calmly towards the retreating party. Kazdor picks up Senkit gently and places her on the side of the horse, sending whatever healing magic he can to stabilize her. Go! I'll be right behind ye, he orders, smacking the horse to get it running. Warpig charges back in and slams into the barbarian, sending it sprawling, landing next to his chief, who looks at the huge boar with a bemused smile. Peregrine rushes up to alongside Andri and places a hand on her shoulder. The healing cannot be complete while those arrows are still in her, but this will at least ensure she doesn't hurt herself anymore by running in her condition. Julian sees the Eort rush by and turns to Kazdor, who still stands ready to act as a rearguard. Don't be a fool, hero, and run, he commands, but Kazdor's will is like the bedrock of the mountains and his rage is a dragon's. Still, he recognizes how desperate the situation is if Julian is daring to use his magic on him and turns. Senkit starts to breath again as Kazdor heals her, and she can feel the motion of a horse and hear the wind rushing by her. No, no, no. She shouts mentally. You can't leave them behind. Get up. Her hand clenches into a fist, and she starts to force her way back into consciousness by sheer force of will. Senkit, stop. She hears a voice, the voice of an old friend, an old mentor. It's okay, Spitfire, rest. Her master's voice assures her, as she drifts into true unconsciousness. Master Arvidor. She whispers as the black takes her. Andri turns in the running dream, hearing footsteps behind her. As the healing magic begins to soothe her, she regains lucidity, and the vision fades, just as she sees four figures pursuing her, the leader with a mace in one hand, and the many-headed scourge in the other. The orc barbarian rolls to his feet, smashing the ground in front of Warpig before slamming it in the side of the head. The stubborn boar doesn't move, and as it rushes forwards for him again, the chieftain steps forwards into its path. With a single uppercut, the orc lord throws Warpig up in the air. The one-eyed monk takes a single step forwards, then plunges his hand into the celestial mount's chest, and rips out its heart. As the creature flickers back to its own plane, he takes an experimental bite of the heart, and sighs when it vanishes. Shame, that was quite good, he says, quite disappointed. Kazdor sees this as he turns to run, and growls, the sweat of his body steaming as he burns with rage, and utters another oath, another grudge to be wiped away in bloody vengeance. He climbs on Julian's horse, and they ride away swiftly. So, they retreat, the chief says as he looks over the damage the party caused. While the party was forced back, they did manage to slaughter most of his foot soldiers. There are only two saviors, aside from Thrawn, who is pulling himself back to consciousness. Turn those two and hunt them down, he orders the ranger. Bring the elf back alive, as well as the dragonborn. They will make fine sacrifices for Lord Grumsh. And the others? The ranger asks. Do as you wish, though I sense that you will be unable to turn them. It will take some time for the change to take place. The ranger says as he looks at the two surviving orcs. They'll have a head start then, I trust you can manage. More than that, means there's sport to be had. The werewolf says as he shifts, snout elongating and bristling with fangs. Before they can resist, the ranger snaps at each, infecting them. It's going to be a strong moon tonight. An excellent night for a hunt, he cackles, looking towards the woods where the paladins fled, tail wagging in anticipation. Be me, the paladins Kazdor, Eort, Andri, Peregrine, Senkit, and Julian, all of whom will be sung of in glory in ages yet to come. Assuming of course they survive a rather inglorious flight from a band of unusually powerful orcs first. Andri leads the back, swiftest of foot, matched with Peregrine atop his trusty steed Bartholomew. For a minute, she runs in spite of the two barbed arrows lodged in her stomach, and then the magic fails, and the pain hits her almost as hard as the arrows did. She falls to a knee, her vision going white. Behind them, Eort rides up with Senkit on the back of his horse. The tiefling lies dreamlessly in a stupor on her stomach. The armor on her back has been blasted apart and her back is a mess of charred flesh after being struck by the Orc Chief's lightning bolt. She'll recover, but in the meantime she's completely out of commission. Soon Kazdor and Julian arrive, both riding Bucephalus, Julian's horse. The stubborn dragonborn isn't letting it show, but his mouth is full of blood. Several of his ribs are cracked and the proud dwarven armor he so cherished is dented into his chest, making breathing difficult and every step of Bucephalus's stride a spike of agony. Julian and Peregrine are both in fairly decent shape, only a few cuts and bruises, but nobody escaped the disastrous ambush unscathed save Eort. "We need to keep moving," Julian says as he dismounts and approaches Undri. "Can we get those out? Barbed heads. Can't just pull it out. Need to cut it out or it'll do even more damage. Going to be difficult to do that with her armor in the way." Peregrine responds as he helps Undri lay down. "Right. Sorry about this, but we can't afford to have you moving," Julian says as he reaches out a mailed glove and crushes it in the air. Undri's entire body stiffens as the Asimov paralyzes her temporarily. "That's the third time ye've used ye magic on us. Do ye make a habit of ripping in tae friends' minds?" Kazdor snarls as he rips his armor off and casts a minor healing on himself to allow himself to breathe again. "If it saves their lives, any day," Julian responds coldly as he reaches down and breaks the arrow's shafts, then lifts Undri's mail out of the way. "Peregrine, do it." Peregrine nods solemnly as he makes a swift incision. Undri strains under the magical grip despite her best efforts, and Julian begins to sweat as her pain echoes across their connection. Fortunately for everyone, Queasy Deutschmark included, Peregrine is a swift surgeon and is able to remove the arrowheads moments before the spell expires. Julian collapses to a knee, sweating heavily before taking off his helmet and vomiting. He reaches out weakly and uses the last of his magic to restore Undri, pulling away his hand unsteadily. Meanwhile, Kazdor attends to Senkit, pouring every bit of magic he has left to pull her body back together. The scorched flesh reknits and smooths. Senkit's eyes flutter open and she turns weakly, smiling at the dragonborn who almost melts in relief. "Can you stand?" Julian asks Undri, staggering to his feet. "Can you?" she asks as she pulls herself to her feet and steadies him. "I'll have to. We need to keep moving. They'll be sending a party after us and we're in no condition to fight it." Senkit makes a weak chirruping noise and her Ignaden, sporting some fresh wounds, runs in. "Take care of her, Un," she asks the elf, who nods and mounts up. Kazdor likewise takes the reins of Bucephalus as Julian takes the back. "About what I said, I owe ye an apology for me words spake in anger," the dragonborn admits. "Considering the mess I just got us into, I'd be more concerned if you weren't angry." Julian chuckles weakly as the party rides off and the sun sets. "Dinny put yourself so high and mighty, laddie. We got ourselves into this mess, but we'll get ourselves out of it, and ye with us. What are friends for, eh? Casting hold person on each other to perform surgery," Julian jokes, and Kazdor blows steam out his nose, then answers him in a low tone that the others, not even keen-eared Undri, come here. "Ah, can you're a willy enough midge to make her take all the pain, ye dinny have ta take it for her, did ye? Believe what you like, lizard, you vastly overestimate my own abilities." Julian lies, not to be too much of a bother, but where in the nine hells are we going? Senkit asks, using her own pool of healing to bring herself back to the land of the living a bit more. "I can't see much past the Ort's legs. Not here. Somewhere we can hide out the night and preferably over a river crossing or something," Eort responds as he keeps riding. The paladins ride on in stoic silence, contemplating their defeat and trying to figure out why it happened. As dusk passes into night, they take camp in a sheltered grove in the shadow of a tall hill, halfway up its side. They light no fire. Julian initially tries to take first watch, but Undri orders him otherwise, somewhat ironically being the first one taken out of the fight and the recipient of so much healing magic means she's in the best shape in terms of health and spells. Julian protests but she orders him to sleep, mimicking his own tone when using command. "Fine," Julian says as he smiles in spite of the situation, "but you're taking the cat at the very least." So that night Undri stands watch alone save for Bast, carefully scanning the forest. She spots movement about 3 hours into her shift, heat in the dark. As she looks more carefully she sees a timber wolf charging towards her out of the trees. She draws back her bow and fires twice, but just like with the Orc Ranger, the arrows break on hitting it. Her eyes widen and she shouts an alarm moments before the ranger pounces, shifting into his hybrid form mid-air. He grabs her by the throat and slams her into a tree, jaws foaming like a rabid mutt. "Hello again, meat. You lost the arrows I gave you. It seems I'll have to replace them." Andri responds by grabbing an arrow from her quiver at her belt, one of the pure silver enchanted arrows. She flips it in her hand and drives it into the werewolf's gut, moonlight flaring from a smite as she does. The werewolf howls in pain as the other paladins swiftly rouse themselves. "No, I lost them. I'll handle replacements," she hisses with a demonic rage that she wasn't ever aware she possessed, as she drives a second into the lycanthrope's shoulder, sending him to his knees as he burns with white fire. As the other paladins get to their feet, the other two werewolves hit their camps from different angles. One hits Kazdor from his side and rips into the unarmored paladin. Another dives at Peregrine, but the nimbler halfling rolls aside and flings his blanket into its face, blinding it. Julian realizes that without rest, none of the party except Eort and Andri will be able to fight this enemy effectively. Seizing the still mostly unpacked supplies, he gives an order: "Disable them if you can, if not get your stuff and retreat." "Easier said than done, laddie," Kazdor shouts as he forces the werewolf's jaws away from his throat. A whinny pierces the night as Bucephalus intervenes, kicking the wolf orc away from him and into a tree. It gets back up and harmed, but Kazdor is able to get to his feet and grab the wolf. He lifts it up in the air and throws it into a tree, where it becomes tangled in the branches. Senkit sees this and takes advantage, hurling hellfire into the tree with the wolf in it and setting it ablaze. The evil flames lick into the wolf and tree with giddy delight, burning the green wood of the tree like tinder. "Uh-oh," Peregrine responds as he sees the fire begin to spread to other trees. Unfortunately, he's not able to deal with the problem immediately as there's still a werewolf trying to eat him. He sighs and grabs his gear, including his trusty frying pan, which he slams into the entangled wolf. It doesn't do any damage, but it does knock it down. Cast iron is heavy no matter how much invincibility you might have. The maned werewolf staggers under the silver and lashes out with his claws. Andri slips out of reach as he tries to pull the arrow out of his stomach and his claw burns as it touches the enchanted silver. "Hurts, doesn't it?" Andri asks coldly before she draws back her bow and puts an arrow into the werewolf's kneecap, dropping it, before she kicks him in the face and puts him on his back. "I imagine this will probably hurt even more," she says as she takes aim and fires an arrow into a particularly sensitive region. The now gelded werewolf really wishes that one had just killed him. The werewolf in the tree, now on fire, manages to fall out of the tree and runs howling and blind through the woods, setting more stuff on fire. The paladins begin to realize that they might win this fight, but they're going to need to run regardless. The trees here are in the shadow of the mountain, meaning that they receive very little rainfall compared with the rest of the wood, and are therefore drier and easier to ignite. That, and hellfire really likes to burn things. The other werewolf shifts back to orc form, pulls the blanket off his head, and sees that the forest is starting to burn down around him. He takes one look at his leader and where that last silver arrow went, sees all the other paladins, and wisely decides to book it as this is not going as planned. As he turns to run, Julian pulls a small glass bottle from his pouch and throws it at the fleeing orc, smiling smugly as it smashes into his back and coats it in its contents. As the orc ducks under a blazing tree, an ember leaps from its branch and onto his back. The oil-coated orc lights up like a Christmas tree. Peregrine, Kazdor, and Senkit gather their remaining provisions and get to the mounts as the smoke starts to build. They have no way to stop this fire and know that they need to get out of there, but Andri is still in there. Andri walks towards the castrated werewolf as he tries to crawl away, amethyst eyes gleaming malevolently. In the dark and the unnaturally colored fire, she looks darker violet and black than pale. She considers simply killing the werewolf with another arrow to the stomach, or perhaps tying an arrow to a spare bowstring and flaying the puny male. Perhaps, she stops herself, horrified at what she's doing and the thoughts running through her head. A voice unforgotten in a tongue unremembered but not misunderstood echoes like the rebuke of a mother. "Child, remember who you are." She shakes her head and flees, leaving the werewolf behind as he manages to start dragging his mangled body away. The party mounts up and flees the fire, riding hard away from the flames into the night, as the fire continues to spread across the mountain in all directions. "Well, this is a lovely mess we've started," Peregrine says as they ride. "I knew we were going to start a forest fire at some point, but I kind of expected it to be Kaz getting drunk. I told ye that story with the assumption that ye'd need tell anyone," the Dragonborn says, turning redder from embarrassment. "On the upside, our trail is fairly well covered," Julian comments dryly as they keep riding. "There," Eort says as he rounds a bend and points down. The party sees a huge pit cut into the earth, with walls and floor of sandstone. "That quarry should be safe." The party continues into the quarry, ridding an old wagon path down into the basin as the fire rages outside and the smoke rises above. Here, though, the air is clear in the old pit. Looking around at the sandstone walls with large holes carved into them, the party realizes that this is where the stone for the abbey must have been cut. As the exhausted party settles into the entrance of one of those holes to rest, they don't even bother unpacking. After this mess of a day, they simply flop down and fall asleep without setting watches. In the depths of the hole they sleep in, forked tongues speak in a hissing language, and a fog of tranquilizing poison floats up out and over the entrance. When the party awakens, they are all standing upright, manacled to a wall. Their weapons are gone, their equipment is gone, their armor is gone, leaving Castor, Senkit, and Julian in nothing but loincloths, and Undri and Peregrine in their tunics. Not that they can see this, except the ones with dark vision, as it is completely black. Those who do have the infrared world on speed dial do see the situation they are in, and the one other creature in the room with them. Its body is cold, far too cold for a normal humanoid, but too warm to be undeared. It has an unusual outline, with a hood that seems to be as warm as its body over its head. The creature moves towards Peregrine, speaking in its unknown hissing tongue, which I translate for your benefit, although the paladins cannot understand. "Small one, devotee of Avery, too different. Not good bargaining chip with dead queen. Probably just sacrifice," he mutters as he doesn't even bother examining him too closely. The creature shows particular interest in Kazeodor, running its fingers over his musculature and bone structure. "Excellent physical specimen. Superb defenses. Actually quite resilient to poison. Excellent candidate for Broodguard. The Junti, which I have nicknamed Dr. Mengele as I don't want to bother hissing up a proper snake name for him," grins venomously and moves on. Kazdor has become rock still, muscles tensed with quiet effort, save for one claw, which is making gestures at Julian. The Arsima sees this and gets the message. Meanwhile, the serpent moves to examine Undri, becoming fascinated with her unusual amethyst eyes. It forces her eye open and gets nose slits to nose with the elf, staring at her eyes. A magnificent, purple in both infrared and normal. Most unusual, very beautiful. Must preserve. Pet, this one. Good test subject for mental magic. Undri aims a knee at the scientist's groin and connects, channeling a smite which causes the second gelding from her today. Julian decides his plan isn't necessary as he hears the slow exhale of wind from the mad doctor's lungs, and taps the side of his manacles, igniting the whole dungeon into indigo light. Kazdor makes his move, and with a mighty pull, rips his manacles off the wall. He steps forwards and seizes the stunned maniacal snake by the throat with them and strangles him to death, picking a key up off of his corpse, then using it to unlock the other's chains. The paladins rub their wrists in silence, still trying to figure out what the hell happened. They don't dare speak for risk of potentially rousing the guards. Eort dips his finger in Mengele's blood and writes on the wall, "Invisibility," then gestures at himself to show he can cast it. The party nods and points at Undri, who nods in agreement, taking the cell key and one of Mengele's scimitars, handing the other to Peregrine. She then nods at Eort to show that she is ready. Eort reaches out and touches her, and Julian drops the light. Undri slips out into the dark hallway and looks both ways. The jail is quite small actually, with only four cells carved into a cul-de-sac hallway. On one end is just a wall, and on the other, a skeletal snake stares eternally down the hallway, perfectly still. There are two paths leading away to the left and right of the undeared guardian, and a door behind it. Moving quickly and quietly up the hallway, Undri peers down each corridor, every hair on her body standing on end and every muscle tensed. She forces herself to control her breathing, despite the cold sweat beginning to form on her brow. She is trapped deep underground in a maze of dark tunnels. She has to get out. She has to get out. She has to get out. The pale-haired elf clenches her fists and grits her teeth, trying to get under control, as she slips around the bone snake and peers through a crack in the door to see what's inside. Jackpot, it seems the G&T stored their equipment here until they could organize it, and a fair bit of a backlog to boot. Knowing the duration of this particular spell, she slinks along the corridors to the left of the undead. This path begins to slope further downwards, so she turns around. She has only one interest, and that is in finding a way out of this. With that thought prominent in her mind, she takes the right path, which curves more upwards. She passes by a large central cavern with a glowing green pool in the center, and a cyclopean alley, stained with blood, in the center. There are many paths out of this room, so she takes the highest one up, reasoning that it'll probably lead her further up. After winding through yet another tunnel, she comes to another large cavern-like area. This time, as she surveys the area, she feels a flicker of hope as she sees light, true light, filter around the corner of one of the passages on the opposite side of the room. As she creeps closer, she feels the invisibility start to flicker. She moves back to the cell, slipping inside just as the time on the spell runs out. As she goes, a Malison Drops steps out of the shadows with a cold smile on his face as he drops the illusion of sunlight. Once back in, she points to the door and then writes, "Bone Snake in the Dead Doctor's Blood." She then writes, "Found exit." The party nods, and Kazdor slams his fist into his palm and points at the words, "Bone Snake," then at Julian and Senkit. They'll apply the correct amount of smite force trauma. Kazdor and the others get to the door, with him in front. He holds up his claw to count down. 3, 2, 1, go. The paladins burst from their cell and rush down the hallway at the bone nigger. Its eyes light up with silent alarm as Kazdor seizes it by the skull and slams it into the ceiling with divine force. Julian grabs it by the tail and pulls, trying to rip the relatively more fragile undead in half, while Senkit pummels its midsection. Meanwhile, Peregrine kicks open the door and Undri rushes in to grab their gear. The first thing she finds is Sen's shield, which she throws to the tiefling. The bone nigger begins to hiss, an impressive feat considering it doesn't have vocal cords, and Julian recognizes what it's doing. It's casting. "Get down," he orders the party. Kazdor drops the serpent and dives to the side as its entire body lights up like a Tesla coil, lighting dancing along its vertebrae and coalescing in its eyes before blasting out. Kazdor avoids the worst of the blast, but it's headed directly for Senkit. Not wanting to be electrocuted again, Sen holds her ground and kicks her shield up in the air, grabbing it and using it to completely deflect the lightning bolt. Her shield sounds like a gong and the lightning screams throughout the halls, the sound echoing through the sandstone tunnels. "So much for stealth," she mutters. "We need to sneak about like rats anyways." Kazdor reassures her, before getting up and smiting the nigger in the face with his right hook. The creature falls, and Kaz crushes its skull under his foot to make sure it stays down. "Still, let's hurry. We've only a matter of time before reinforcements arrive," Julian advises, and the party quickly gathers their gear and redons their armor. Sen's is a bit less effective than usual due to most of the black still missing, and Kazdor's is uncomfortable due to the dents, but it's better than fighting naked. However, once they gather all their equipment, Julian realizes that arguably their most valuable item is missing. "My spellbook," he curses. "It's not here." He paces for a moment. "Right, they must have a proper caster to create a monster like that, he or she must have it, just have to find the caster." "Need laddie," Kazdor says as he sends out a ping and locates the spellbook. "It's above us, and slightly to the left." "Right, we get that, and we get out," Julian says as he loads and cocks his crossbow. "We'll have company," Undri says as her pointed ears twitch. "Something's large coming from both sides. We're going to have to fight our way out. On the plus side, that is more or less what we do best." "Right, Kazdor, Peregrine, on me, we'll take point on getting out of here. Senkit, Yort, rearguard. Undri, support them. Go for anything that'll slow the enemy down." The party nods and moves out, Julian igniting his blade in indigo light as he charges upwards. "Order on me," he roars as he pushes forwards. Ahead of him stand four large, lanky humanoids, with scaly skin and long claws. The brute guards hiss in discomfort as the sudden light momentarily blinds them as the warhawk falls upon them. Shadows dance madly in the tunnel. Julian carves a bleeding X into the first guard, but he stops in surprise as the wretched beast doesn't fall. Kazdor and Peregrine are likewise astounded by these creatures' tenacity. Kaz splits open one's belly, cracks into its shoulder, and removes half the flesh on its forearm, but it doesn't go down. Likewise, Peregrine slashes open major arteries in the legs, but the creature comes on regardless of the red fountaining from its wounds. What in the hells? Are they undead? Peregrine asks, confused as he recklessly attacks, sparing not a moment for defense, managing to throw the halfling back with a claw mark on his shoulder. Kaz is able to keep out of the way thanks to his superior reach, but the unwounded one throws itself on him, biting a chunk out of his shoulder. Julian watches curiously as the one he mortally wounded throws itself at him, forcing him to retreat to avoid being slashed. In the back line, the female paladins are having any more luck. Senkit positions herself in the hall and blocks three of them, stopping one in their tracks with her shield, taking a second's claws and teeth on her armor, and sweeping her Morning Star across to keep a third from getting to Undri, cracking it across the head for good measure. The one that does get to Undri starts its charge poorly as she puts two arrows into it. It closes, slashing and biting, but she manages to keep out of its way. Undri palms her dagger and stabs it into the creature's chest up to the hilt, forcing it off and giving her enough room to draw her saber and decapitate the beast in one smooth motion. Meanwhile, Senkit smashes one into the cavern wall and it falls to the floor stunned, before dealing with the wounded one by breaking its jaw and then its neck. Yort moves in on the last brood guard standing, flanking it. His gladius flashes twice in the dark and comes away soaked in blood, the serpent with two narrow cuts in its ribs. Julian and his flank take full advantage of the reckless Juanti. The Arsimer turns his one step back into a whirl of slashes forwards, cutting down the weakened brood guard and then flowing to remove both the arms from the one attacking Peregrine. The halfling pays it forwards by rolling between Kazdor's legs to stab the last healthy snake in the knees. Kazdor takes advantage of his unsteady opponent and hits it in the stomach and then the head, before turning and uppercutting the last lunging brood guard in the chin with his axe. As the front falls apart, Senkit drives off the back. As the fallen Juanti tries to get up, she puts it back down with a strike from her Morning Star. Yort takes a claw on his shield and pushes forwards, throwing off the bite aimed at Sen's neck. Undri fires into the melee and drops the brood guard before grabbing her dagger and retreating. Senkit breaks the last one's back and does the same, Yort following closely behind, but scanning the back. Not quite well enough though, as he misses the very human-looking Publood sneaking back down the tunnel into the lower reaches of the cave. She eventually reaches a heavily guarded door. Every Juanti bar the few brood guards dispatched at Chonhite's orders has assembled in front of those doors, ready to give their lives to protect it. Pitmaster, the prisoners are headed for the upper levels. The brood guards are dead and the worms are escaping. She hisses in a report to a well-dressed and armored Malison. Good. The Malison responds, then explains at his acolyte's confused look. It means that they are moving away from here, and may leave this place altogether and never return, meaning that they may never pose a threat to our continued survival. Even though they're busy cutting their way through the upper levels on their way out, so long as the egg chamber remains guarded, we will endure. The Malison responds coldly. And the fact that they may kill Schonheit and Abtraum on their way out also helps. The Malison smiles slightly. I am disappointed at the loss of Dr. Mingeli, but the removal of those two obstacles might prove beneficial. Another Malison looks from the shadows at the Pitmaster and initiates telepathic contact. They have located the spellbook and are headed for Abtraum, and I fooled the she-elf meat with the illusion earlier. Excellent. Everything should be progressing just according to plan. Meanwhile, the paladins keep running forwards, arriving at the first main room, the one with the altar. At just the right time to see a different Publood running away to raise the alarm that the brood guards failed. I highly doubt they'll underestimate us again. Hurry! Peregrine warns as the paladins follow the psychic trail towards the spellbook. As they get close, Julian smiles as he feels his connection with Bust return. He looks through his familiar's eyes to try to see where he is. That was just what Alptraum was waiting for. Julian sees the interior of what is clearly a spellcaster's laboratory and a female Madison for a split second before she hisses a spell and sprays Bast with the powerful ast. The backlash as his familiar is banished drives Julian to his knees and he goes momentarily blind as his mind tries to readjust. The others slow to help him. On the right track, go! Kill that bitch for me. He orders them, and Andre gestures for them to go while she stays to watch Julian. What happened? She asks. Bitch killed my cat. He responds. Backlash turned my eyes off for a minute. Andre is about to respond when she hears something, like knives tapping on the stone floor, and her skin begins to crawl. Do you hear that? She asks Julian. Hear what? That. She whispers as the tapping grows progressively louder, before a long metal spider's leg reaches over this tunnel's entrance and stabs into the ceiling. Kazdor and the others, using one of his axes as a light source, break into the spellcaster's room and find it empty. They proceed carefully, finding jars of God only knows what, books in forbidden languages bound in what looks disturbingly like human skin, a cage with bars still smoking from acidic residue. On the desk, they see Julian's book and Senkit grabs it. Whoever owns that thing is a rather naughty fellow. A female voice croons through the room. I mean, half the spells are in a different language, so he probably stole it to begin with. But there's some truly nasty stuff hidden in there if you know what to look for. The voice cackles. The party gets back to back, huddled close together. Where the hell's is the hag? Kazdor grumbles, before she slides out of the shadows in the entrance of the room. Right here. She says sweetly. And then the room goes dark, cold, acidic, and is filled with an uncomfortable amount of tentacles. Andre takes a step back, and then another, her body moving before she can stop it. Her heart is beating like it's trying to jump out of her chest and her breathing is rapid and irregular. Julian asks as he fumbles in the dark. She wants to go and help him but can't make herself move towards the thing dragging itself into the tunnel, then crawling at her from across the ceiling. It is a gigantic metal spider, with a black iron body and a face like a mask of white steel and 6 onyx eyes. It rushes along the ceiling at her and Andre turns and runs, screaming. The paladins in the hungry void realize very quickly they need to get out of this mess and try to move for the entrance. Unfortunately, in the dark and the tentacles, Eort, Kazdor, and Peregrine all go the wrong ways and bump into the walls and each other. Senkit though hears Andre's scream and moves towards that, breaking free just in time for the nightmare speaker to blast her in the chest, hurling her back into the hungry dark. Julian struggles to reorient and control his whirling mind. He is still lucid, but his subconscious is fully expecting to be dead even though he knows it was only Bast that died. He fights to force his eyes open as he hears the trouble Andre and the others are in. Andre runs at full tilt, only to feel a beam slam into her from behind and she falls to her face. She rolls over and backs away, too terrified to stand as the mechanical monstrosity grows ever closer. She tries to back away, but she feels constricting coils wrap around her and lift her up closer, crushing the life from her body as she is offered up like a sacrifice to the oncoming arachnid. Kazdor is nearly toppled over as Senkit flies into him. Grab my tail. She orders him, and he grasps it firmly. Eort, also bumping into the dragonborn, grabs him, and Peregrine grabs him. Senkit charges out of the dark and roars in fury as she smashes the Jumti warlock in the back of her head with her mace, twice. The stunned shaman is unable to maintain her grip on Andre or on her magic, and both the nightmare illusion and the hungry void vanish. And yes, I know she technically couldn't do both at once roar, but it made for a more interesting encounter. Andre staggers to her feet as the supernatural terror departs and a burning rage like no other takes hold. She whirls on the warlock and tears into her, normally elegant blades turned to scourges to rip and gouge at the icon of fear. Altrom realizes she's made a terrible mistake as terror grips her heart. With a hissing curse she seizes Senkit and Andre in a magical grip and hurls them aside, slithering past their bodies suspended in the air, grasping at their throats. She rushes past Julian just as the Arsima gets to his feet and puts his mind back together enough for his eyes to work again. When the first thing he sees is the bitch who caused him that hell in the first place, his eyes ignite. He whirls at the fleeing warlock and crushes his gauntlet into a fist, stopping her dead in her tracks and magically lifting her off the floor by her throat. You killed my cat, you're dead, he declares calmly. Kazdor moves to make good on that promise, just as he ought. A crossbow bolt and three axe blows render the warlock three different kinds of dead before Julian drops the spell, and her body. Senkut attends to her, Peregrine, and Undri's physical wounds, expending a substantial amount of healing magic in the process, but Un is still something of a wreck. She shakes involuntarily at Senkut's touch and is still breathing heavily. She is enraged, both at the warlock for her enchantment and herself for falling for it, and the thought of that metal monster still makes her recoil. Peregrine senses this and walks over to the kneeling elf. He takes her head in his hands and looks at her eye to eye. Everyone feels fear, Un, and everyone falls to it sometimes. You are a hero, you'll beat this. Adding some magic to his words for good measure. Un nods and stands upright steadily. I have had it with these 9 times damned snakes in this 10 times damned hole. She curses, and the crew lets out a few laughs from weary nerves in relief. Eort hands Julian his book, and the later thanks him for it. He goes to put it away, but opens it to check for something. He smiles as he puts it away. The important bit was still there. The spells, those could always be reclaimed. But the picture of the smiling woman looking up at him from the inside cover, that couldn't be bought again for a dragon's hoard. He smiles and puts it away. We're almost out of here, let's go. He says as the party moves out, Undri at the head. The Juanti are coming out in force to try and stop them, so Kazdor picks up the warlock's body and hurls it at them. The serpent folk pull back in horror, and then rout as Julian charges, his aura of terror all about him. The paladins aren't trying to fight all the serpents, there's simply too many, but with Julian's fear aura making a path they run for it to the passage that Undri identified. And every serpent following them stops once they enter that passageway. Undri thinks that it is strange how they're doing that, but keeps running, seeing a golden light ahead filtering through a door and rushes through. What she finds is not the outside, but it still makes her stop in her tracks. The others filter in and are similarly awed. This is a room worthy of an emperor. The floor is smooth and carven in strange patterns, furniture lies about it, a long divan, a magnificent bed, each of different make but still marvelously made. Torches hang on the walls, one of which is covered in a huge mural depicting a gigantic man serpent with 4 arms holding 4 scimitars. In the center of the room is a shallow pool under a glass skylight looking up into a blue sky. It is, in other words, the opulent boudoir of a raging narcissist with a god complex, who decided to spend more time and resources on his own private quarters than all his underlings' accommodations combined. There's a reason they weren't going to stop the party if they decided to head up and trash this place. Well, not the way out I had in mind, but it'll do. Undri says as she heads for the pool and looks up. Good thing we brought rope, we'll use the same trick we did to get over the walls, or I could fly. Julian responds as he walks over and flares his wings, just as he's about to take off. Aztec Snake of Fitness.mp3. The abomination, Schoenheit, bursts from the wall where he had posed himself exactly as the mural of himself was. Catching the party completely by surprise and actually making Senkut feel slightly insecure. He also has an attractiveness of 100. As he bursts with lightning speed, he slashes open long cuts on Senkut and Kazdor, wraps around Julian, and rains 2 blows down on Undri, knocking her into the pool, which quickly turns sanguine. Foolish meat, you dare disturb a god, he mockingly demands. You shall all perish for this blasphemy. The party is a little too dumbfounded to react at first, before Kazdor responds with axes and curses. A god would have a wee better plan than pretend iron to be a wall, ye mad skinner. He roars as he lays into the psychotic serpent's coils, blasting into them with smites, but unable to do much real damage. My expression is a gift unto all lesser beings, the common grace that they may gaze upon the ultimate life form. It condescendingly sneers as it shrugs off the blows like they're nothing. If you're the ultimate life form, I'm Muradin's grandfather. Undri says sarcastically as she pulls herself out of the pool and fires at the maniac, who cuts her arrows out of the air. Julian takes this opportunity and places his hands on the abomination's sides, then focuses. 2 pulses of red power blast the constricting coils apart, allowing the Usimir to fly free and breathe. Senkut takes advantage and slams into the snake at full charge, but he is simply too heavy to knock over. She responds by repeatedly hitting him with a mace, again seeming to amuse it more than hurt, Even though she does break bones and draw blood, Peregrine runs out the coils, through the whirling blades, and cuts the Juanti across the chest and neck before jumping free, the distraction allowing York to nail him with a crossbow bolt. Irritated at Peregrine's impudence, Schonhide focuses his full fury on the halfing, growing more enraged with every blow as his every attack seems to either just miss by a turn of fate or be deflected by the swift blades of the smaller, more skilled duelist. Enraged, he grabs Peregrine in his coils and hurls him across the room into Eort, knocking both over. Oh, that could be a neat trick though. Peregrine grins as he considers the potential of a fastball special. Kazdor and Senkit work in tandem to deal with both sides, the serpent fending off both but taking blows on his arms. Undri takes advantage and fires into his back. Schonhide turns to face her, and is surprised when Julian flies in and cuts open first his face, then cuts off an arm before landing. A good hit, but you cannot kill me. The deranged serpent hisses. I am a god, he declares, as he strikes out in every direction, throwing the paladins back. Eort focuses, and a copy of himself appears behind the Serpent King, loading a false crossbow. Peregrine picks himself up and looks at the crazed creature, uncertain of how to engage considering hitting it didn't appear to be slowing it down. Schonhide grabs Senkit with his tail and holds her upside down before using her as a weapon to smash Peregrine aside, while blow after blow smashes through guard and armor alike, forcing Kazdor to his knees. Kazdor gets up and blasts the abomination with a gout of fire, which it flows through burned but unflinching. Senkit leans up in and crushes the end of its tail, but it doesn't stop moving. Undri loads her magic arrows and fires, hitting the monster in the hand, but still it rants, rages, and raves. Julian snarls to his feet and roars in again, striking the false god from behind and running him through from back to front. The abomination drops one of its swords, and for a moment, they think it is done, before it turns around and grabs the Arsimer by the throat and picks him up. Insolent boy, you can kill my minions, you can enter my comb chambers, but you cannot. Schonhide's words are failing him, as is his grip. He drops Julian and staggers forwards towards him, blood falling from his mouth. You cannot kill a god, he hisses with his last breath. Schonhide might have been deluded enough to believe he was immortal, but his body said otherwise. Just did. Julian says calmly as he retrieves his bloody-stained sword and washes it in the pool, before flying up and letting down a rope. The paladins climb up and mend their wounds, before moving out at great speed in the opposite direction of the quarry. As night falls, they finally stop to rest and set up camp, spirits high once more. Well, that was a bloody great mess. Kazdor rumbles, if Anna see Anna snake again it'll be too soon. I concur. Double if them midges. Undri says with a frown as she sits down and shivers. What did you see that scared you so much anyways? Peregrine asks curiously. Undri shivers again. Giant mechanical spider. Yep, I don't blame you in the slightest. Peregrine says, even the fearless halfling agrees that is just plain horrifying. Am I the only one who thought that was a little too easy? Senkit asks, rubbing her shoulder. No. Julian says, frowning. I get the feeling there's more going on here than we realize. Well, we'll deal with the Skinner's scheming when it comes up. For now, sleep. Kazdor rumbles as he rolls over, and Set watches.